Our next speaker, Dr. Julie Edmunds, is the director of the Early College Research Center at the University of North Carolina at Greensboro, where she conducts research focused primarily on high school reform and the transition to college. A centerpiece of her work is a 17-year experimental study on the impact of early colleges, which is actually one of the first external linking projects that we've done at the data center and one of our most longstanding research projects. She uses multiple methods ranging from experimental and quasi-experimental designs to formative developmental approaches to evaluate the implementation and impact of different educational programs. Welcome, Dr. Edmunds.
Thank you. Delighted to be here, and hello to everyone online. As Kara said, I've been working with her for a long time, so since 2006. And so today I'm going to share our early college study, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the study and our findings, but mostly sort of explaining the data and the different sources of data and how we used NCERDC to accomplish that. So there we go. First, how many people know what early colleges are? All right, most people do. So I would hazard a guess that if I had asked this question back in 2006, one hand that went up. So they have become much more common. So early colleges are really a model of schooling that merges high school and college together. So students are simultaneously enrolled in high school and college. In North Carolina, their name is Cooperative Innovative High Schools. We have about 130 of them, and we are one of the states that sort of went all in at the beginning and has some of the strongest commitment to this particular model. Students are enrolled starting often in grades 9, and then it goes through grade 12, or as Kara mentioned earlier, some of them go through grade 13, so they're five-year programs for some of them. And the focus is not on gifted students. So the focus is really on students who are underrepresented in higher education. So students who are capable of doing college-level work, but might face some challenges in enrolling. So maybe they're the person in their family to go to school. Maybe they're low-income students. Maybe they're students who might belong to racial or ethnic groups that have historically faced challenges in accessing higher education. These schools are often located on college campuses. Almost all of them in North Carolina are. There's one here at North Carolina Central. There's not one here at Duke, I will say. There's one at North Carolina Central. There's one at NC State. And then the vast majority of them are located on community college campuses. Students start taking college courses in as early as ninth grade. And the idea is that by the time they graduate from high school, they get their high school diploma and an associate degree or 2 years of transferable college credit. So we've actually been testing the impact of North Carolina's model. So as I mentioned, North Carolina was an early adopter, and we've been fortunate enough to have basically continuous funding from the Institute of Education Sciences for the past 17 years to follow these students in real time. And we have a current grant from Arnold Ventures to do this as well. Our study is a 17-year experimental study comparing students who applied and were randomly offered a spot in the early college with students who applied and were randomly turned down. And I'll talk more about that in a minute. And then because we've been able to follow these students in real time, we're looking at a ton of different outcomes. So we're looking at their experience in high school. So we've got outcomes related to course taking, academic performance, behavior, attitudes, dropout, graduation from high school. We follow them into post-secondary education. So we have post-secondary enrollment, post-secondary performance, post-secondary credentials. We are in the process of linking our sample to data from the Department of Commerce on employment insurance data to get wage and earnings outcomes. That's the only part that's not being done through NCERDC, and I'm happy to talk about that later if people want. But it is going through GDAC and the work that Tripp Stallings and the folks over there, Ashley Seaman, are doing. So again, our study design, our sample. So early colleges are schools of choice, and this is important to know. And the experimental design basically builds on the fact that more students applied than were spots, than the schools could accommodate, basically. So the students apply, schools did some screening, and we exerted no control over that screening. We just said do whatever we would normally do. And then the last stage of the selection process was a random assignment, a lottery process. And we did, as the research team, did the lottery for most of the schools. Our full sample of schools is 19 early colleges, over 4,000 students who applied. And we had cohorts that entered ninth grade starting in 2005-06, and our last cohort entered in 2010-11. So all of our cohorts at this point are 6 years out from 12th grade. So we've got post-secondary credential attainment for 6 years out. So as a reminder, our treatment students and our students who applied to the early college made it through the screening process, made it through the lottery, randomly selected to attend. Our control group, students applied to the early college, made it through the screening process, went through the lottery, were not selected to attend. The control students generally went to business as usual, which was usually the comprehensive high school in the district. So where the study has been going on as long, we have a lot of different data sources that we've been able to link to. So the starting point was the application data. And so this was application data from participating schools. And again, we had to recruit the schools to agree to work with us from the beginning. The application form included a study consent form at the time that students were applying to the school. Then what we did basically is, I'll talk about that in a minute. The other data we had is the high school data from North Carolina Department of Public Instruction, housed here at NCERDC. We also did a survey administered by ourselves that really captured some of those more affective outcomes and experiential outcomes that are not present in the administrative data. And so that was for a subset of our sample. And then we also have linked to post-secondary data from the National Student Clearinghouse, from the University of North Carolina, and from the Community College. So let me go back, sorry. So for linking to the NCERDC data, so we submitted a proposal NCERDC back in 2006, and Kara was here, actually. So, and the process was very similar. I think the process has not really changed that much over time. And then what we had is we had those list of applicants. And so we had paper applications from the schools. They gave us paper applications. We entered the data into Excel spreadsheets, uploaded the Excel spreadsheet to Kara, and she did her matching. And gave us a de-identified list of students with just the MAST ID. And so, and then we used the same procedure for the survey matching and the NSP matching as well, where we would send the detailed information to her, she would de-identify it and link it to the rest of the data. We had to use a different process for the UNC system data and the North Carolina Community College system data. So basically what we did was get our sample information, the directory level information, name and birth date, went to the UNC and the community college system. They pulled relevant students from their sample. And then the agency then submitted this detailed and identifiable, at that point, identifiable data to NCERDC, where Kara again went through magic and did the matching there. And that created a de-identified data set for our own analyses. We needed to have additional data sharing agreements with those agencies to make that happen. So we had separate agreements with the community college system and with the UNC system. These data, as Kara has mentioned, are provided only for this study. So they are not, even though NCERDC houses them for our purposes, they're not available for other researchers or other studies at this point. And then we paid NCERDC for all of this linking according to their customary charges. And I will say that was money well spent, because if you think about the amount of time and effort that it would have taken to do that otherwise, it would be impressive. So what did we find? So I'm going to share some results from the impact analyses. So we actually found a positive impact on just about everything that we've looked at. So the early college students had better attendance. They had reduced suspension. On the survey, they reported better experiences in high school, particularly in their early years. They were more likely to take and complete the high school courses that were required for entrance into college. They earned a much higher number of college credits while they were in high school. That's kind of not surprising. It's slightly higher high school graduation rate. The only negative impact we found was on our survey, which was a negative impact on self-efficacy and age, which I think was because they were being asked to work harder than they were than the students in the regular high school did. So here's some results showing the impact on post-secondary credential attainment by this group by 6 years after 12th grade. So we see large positive impacts on any post-secondary credential. That's driven primarily by large impacts on the existing degree attainment, which makes sense because, again, many of these schools are located on community college campuses and students are actually getting associate degrees at the same time that they graduate from high school. The bachelor's degree, a small positive impact, marginally significant. And I hate that term, but it's showing up at about 0.08 for the significance level. When we look at the results for economically disadvantaged students in particular, so there are certain populations that are benefiting more, and economically disadvantaged students have the largest impact on bachelor's degree attainment, where that's a substantial 6 percentage point and statistically significant impact there, and continue to have a very large impact on associate degree attainment. So I want to just reflect briefly on some of the implications of this work. And I will say that we could not have done this work without the data set. Like, there's no way that we could have done all of this. And so when I think about kind of the benefits of this work, early college really has significantly expanded over time. And our work, and there was another RCT that was done where we were actually able to share some data with that national RCT. So our data has been used as justification for that expansion. And so as a result, we really feel like more students are graduating from college. So students are having better experiences as a result. And our study has contributed to that. The U.S. Department of Ed at this point regularly cites early college as a proven model. And then I know there's a lot of academics here. There are some professional benefits as well. I mean, personally, it really led to a very focused research agenda and the creation of a center that we have right now. We've been fortunate enough, again, to receive extensive federal funding for our research, and that was because we had access to the data, right? And we were able to really, again, make all these connections here. And we've had substantial publication success as a result, and have had some award-winning publications in top-tier journals, and we have a book that's actually out published by Harvard Ed Press this fall that allows us to, basically present all the results of 16 years worth of work. I warned them. I said it was going to be a little bit of a marketing thing and they didn't ask me to do this. They did not ask, but I'm a big fan of NCERDC because I really think, this just having a center like this makes it so much easier to do important and policy relevant work on a large scale. And again, as I mentioned, I don't think we could not. The cost is substantially less than the time that you would spend otherwise collecting the data. It minimizes just using administrative data and minimizes attrition, improving the quality of the study, so we don't have to go out and collect, survey students about whether they graduated from high school or something like that. As Kara mentioned, the data sharing and request process is very streamlined. So it's much shorter than if you were to negotiate directly with the agencies themselves, which can often take 6 months to a year or multiple years, depending on where you're trying to get access to the data. And again, it's the ability to link your sample and other data to state law and historical data. I mean, that really can't be underestimated. So I'm a big fan of NCERDC and people who just share all the work that they've done. So I'm going to pause there and see if people have any questions.
I'm going to ask about attrition. In the context you're working in is so unique and interesting, as kids graduate from high school and move on perhaps to other states and other places. How has that affected your work or maybe enhanced with the National Clearinghouse data or the national student data as well?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. And so, and that's where the National Student Clearinghouse data really comes in. So I will say we are in the process of trying to link again to wage and earnings. And so that's going to restrict our sample because we're using unemployment insurance data in North Carolina. That's going to restrict our sample to students that remain in North Carolina. I will say we're just in the process, and I think we have about, so GDAC is helping us match to SSN, that's then going to wage and earnings. And I think the match rate, we're at about 90%. And so our RCT is going to, it's amazing. Amazing. Yeah.
Can you just tell people what the GDAC is for those?
Oh, sure. So GDAC is the Government Data Analytics Center, and it's housed under, Caitlin can correct me, Department of Information Technology. And that, and it currently houses the state's longitudinal data system, which is kind of in the process of really being developed as a usable system for external researchers to be able to access. And our study right now is a case study, so we're helping them sort of pilot some procedures in terms of being able to do some of this linking so that other researchers then hopefully will be able to come behind and it'll be easier for them. Thank you. Any other questions?
Here is what came in through the chat. Suggestion for your next step. Compare the preparation that early college students receive at different schools. From the perspective of college faculty, some come to our classes ready to succeed. Others have placed without any preparation for college at all. That might help add more nuance to your results.
Yeah. So there's a lot of... I think there's a lot more we can understand too about sort of their performance. We have looked at post-secondary performance, and on average, we don't see any difference in GPA between early college students and other students. Because some people might say, well, you're shortening the amount of time that they have. You've taken what would normally take 6 years, which is 4 years of high school plus 2 years of college, and you're truncating it to either 4 years or 5 years. So aren't they missing something? Right. And at this point, we don't have any evidence of that. Now, and I think it's a great idea to do the more nuanced. I know some folks are starting to look at the preparation of those who are in early colleges affiliated with four-year institutions versus two-year institutions, and that's kind of a natural next step for us too. We can't do it in the RCT framework because our RCT sample is too small, but because we only have 19 early colleges. But we are looking, we're doing a quasi-experimental study of the entire state of North Carolina. We can look more at those sorts of issues.
Just following up, my assumption is when you link to the NCERDC, you were using it to get the control group information. You did not look at earlier schooling, like middle school outcomes for any of these kids going into early colleges and things. So or did you look? My assumption is the NCERDC link is to see for your control group, to see how the control group does in high school. But did you look at all at middle school, like any data pre-entry into early college, because I think they were talking about sort of where students were going into early college, but y'all didn't look at that, right?
Oh, I thought the question was, so we have those data. We use it in terms of just making sure that our students are the same, and we use them as covariates in our analysis and things like that. Yeah.
That was what I was.
We use that, but I think the question was about whether different early college experiences make a difference, whether where early colleges are. I think that's where they were going, whether that changes their outcomes in post-secondary. That's how I interpreted the question. But yeah. So we do have that. We do have middle school data. Yes. I mean, we have all the data that NCERDC has going all the way back to wherever. But we use the middle school data again as covariates and to check balance and stuff like that.
Okay.